There are two differences between a regular presentation and a keynote. A keynote can be longer and a keynote can be less rigorous. So I will attempt to satisfy both conditions. This is joint work, as you can see, with my colleagues at the Fund and the European Central Bank, and it's really on a central issue in monetary and financial economics, namely the impact of technology, information technology in the present case, on the behavior and stability of financial markets, specifically how they react to information, an issue on which, as I write here, it's fair to say there are two views. So this, in fact, is where the title comes from. So Arnaud, in particular, is fond of these kind of analogies, which, to my mind, may confuse more than they illuminate. So I'm not sure how much I'm going to come back to which one is the thick-skinned case and which one is the thin-skinned case, but we will see. So the first of the two views is that more efficient information technology causes asset prices to react more to information. There are arguments out there that IT enables trading strategies associated with volatility, algorithmic trading, stop-loss rules, fire sale rules, high-frequency trading more generally, that it encourages trend following, it increases in strategic complementarities with public and private information. So, for example, there is this classic paper from Morrison Shin, in which if traders overreact to public information because of these strategic complementarities, other traders are reacting to public information as well. More public information can, in fact, mean more volatility. Separate from that, there is also the argument that information technology can be a source of misinformation, of spurious rumors, as, for example, in this instance from 2013, when the White House's Twitter account was hacked. You may recall, and I'm sorry, was the Associated Press's Twitter account that was hacked, reporting explosions at the White House that injured President Obama, none of which was, in fact, the case. But it led to this crash in financial markets about which it was written, though it will be months before you know exactly what happened. The consensus is that a handful of trading algorithms responded to the fake tweet by selling a broad range of stocks, bonds, and commodities as message traffic spiked and prices started declining. High-frequency trading firms started backing out of the market just as they did during the May 2010 flash crash, causing volatility to spike. And there is, similarly, that May 2010 case when the Standard & Poor's 500 and a variety of other stock indices crashed for a few minutes and then rebounded in the absence of a obvious trigger, which is to say, in response to, at best, small bits of news, news about the world, perhaps, or simply news about the action of other traders. So this showed, according to some analysts, how so-called advances in information and communications technology can amplify market reactions and volatility. But there is also the second view that information technology, advances in information technology, may cause asset prices to react by less to the same news. It's argued that better information made possible by this technology leads to smaller departures from equilibrium prices, also possibly faster convergence to those equilibrium prices. IT can increase the share of informed investors in the market. There are a number of models out there. I cite a couple of them here, in which uninformed investors buy when prices are rising. They sell when prices are falling, amplifying volatility, but information technology can reduce the share of uninformed investors in the market, and through that channel, cause asset prices to react by less. There's the obvious identification problem when trying to bring these ideas to the data, notably that, namely that technology can be endogenous. Given the possibility that investors in and adopters of technology are likely to respond to events and incentives, events in and incentives provided by financial markets. Ideally, we would want a measure of technology that's exogenous, but also heterogeneous across time and space, providing more variation and enabling us to pursue, test a variety of related hypotheses. So in this paper, we argued that history provides just such a measure of technology, namely submarine fiber optic cables. The laying of subsurface oceanic below the ocean, hence submarine fiber optic cables, started in the late 1980s. The first transatlantic fiber optic cable was 1989. There was spatial and intertemporal variation. The network was built out gradually over time. It connected up different countries and markets in different years, and I'll talk more about how and why that came about. And I'll argue that the rollout of this network was exogenous with respect to events in financial markets. Something tells me we're going to come back to that assumption. But my argument will be that cables were not laid for purposes related to electronic trading of foreign exchange, which is what we study in the paper. Rather, their underwriters saw them as cheap, efficient, and profitable conduits for long-distance telephone calls in the first instance, and eventually for telephonic and fax traffic, and eventually for internet connectivity. Only over time was their utility for electronic trading of foreign exchange and other financial instruments discovered. Of course, you will question this exogeneity assumption, and we have some other instrumental variable strategies for dealing with the obvious qualms. So we analyzed the reaction of foreign exchange markets specifically to news. The foreign exchange market is the largest financial market in the world in terms of turnover, in terms of the value of transactions. It's dispersed geographically, so we can take advantage of differences in cable connectivity at different times in different places. And the transactions are standardized. We can express them, they're standardized instruments, so the reaction in different venues and locations can be compared. So what do we do specifically? We look at the impact of cable connections on the reaction of the foreign exchange market to macroeconomic news. We consider the reaction of 56 bilateral exchange rates against the US dollar using daily observations, New York market close of business, 1997 through 2015. And I'll explain the reason for that sample period a little bit more as we go. We look at news about the US economy, although there's some sensitivity analysis looking at other measures of news. The Federal Reserve's policy interest rate, the US GDP growth rate, news about US industrial production, news about US consumer price inflation, news about US unemployment, news about the US trade balance. You may like or dislike the focus on bilateral dollar exchange rates and US news. Helen Ray, were she already here? I don't see her yet. Hi, Helen. Undoubtedly will like this because she argues for the disproportionate importance of the US policy rate and other events affecting the US economy and the dollar for financial markets worldwide. We find that cable connections dampen the response of the exchange rate to news, and we find that the effects are economically large. So the presentation will walk through the history of submarine fiber optic cables, the identification strategy and testable hypotheses, the results, some more about the validity of the identification strategy, and then the conclusions. So if you visit the Museum of the City of London, you will see an exhibit on the first submarine cable connecting France with England, which dates from the 1850s. This is a technology that an American, Samuel Morse, developed. Samuel Morse of Morse code fame, who submerged a cable made up out of coiled copper wire covered in tarred hemp and rubber in New York Harbor in 1842, and he demonstrated the feasibility of passing electric current through the copper wire, which was how he could send the dashes and dots, and similar cables covered with gum from Malaysian gutta percha trees started connecting Great Britain with the European continent in the 1850s, transatlantic cable in the 1860s, and then other cables followed. There's a whole ecological disaster story about the Malaysian gutta percha tree actually having to do with its intensive use in insulating submarine copper cables. So the first transatlantic cable was laid unsuccessfully in the event in 1858. There was this message, if your eyesight is good, from Queen Victoria to President Buchanan, transmitted over the course of 6.5 hours. It took time for that electrical impulse to travel across the North Atlantic. The cable failed after, I think, something like a week. The picture here is of New York City Hall and the fireworks display that they shot off on the day this first message was successfully transmitted. That burned down New York City Hall, in fact. The problem with the failure of the cable is that laying all this cable, you needed a very big ship to carry these very large spools of copper cable, one from the west, one from the east, to meet in the middle. So they wanted to lay it where the ocean floor was not too deep. The problem being that the particular route that they shown here also suffered from very strong currents that ripped the cable in half after 6 weeks. So they went back to the drawing board. They discovered a slightly different route. They succeeded in 1866, and then other cables of coiled copper wire surrounded by gutta percha or rubber, now surrounded in turn by an outer layer of iron or steel wire, connected a growing range of countries. So the figure on the right is the Eastern Telegraph Company circa turn of the 20th century. But these submarine cables were subject to reliability and capacity problems. The story of unreliability comes back when we get to fiber optic cables, which is why I'm kind of belaboring it here. When they used copper cables, they had to use very high voltages to transmit electric impulses over long distances, which created distortion, limited carrying capacity, heightened the risk of short-circuiting as well. Over time, they figured out how to transmit at higher frequencies. They figured out how to place repeater amplifiers, little amplifiers along the cable itself, enabling the use of lower voltages. Those important breakthroughs, like the Audion shown on the right, were early 20th century, but it took another 50 or so years before this new technology was really rolled out on a global basis. There wasn't much investment in it during the Great Depression of the 1930s. There was no investment in it during World War I and II. So you get the first modern submarine cable, TAT-1, transatlantic telephone number one, or transatlantic number one for short. There you have a little hint of my exogeneity assumption in the name, which is now a coaxial cable. So for the students in the audience, you'll remember your great-grandfather's stereo system where the components were connected to one another using coaxial cables, now of solid copper rather than coiled wire, insulated now using polyurethane rather than gutta percha, using vacuum tubes as repeaters. So the 1955 version TAT-1 was the first cable with the capacity to carry telephone calls across the Atlantic. It connected Scotland and Newfoundland, laid further north than the original cable, suffering from scouring currents. And importantly, again, for my story, it was underwritten by AT&T, the Canadian Overseas Telecommunications Corporation, and the UK Post Office, which ran the British telephone system for the purpose of carrying telephone calls. Coaxial cables finally were superseded by fiber optic cables in the 1980s. And as you know, fiber optics transfer light rather than electricity. Data moves faster at the speed of light in glass rather than at the speed of electricity in metal, on the order of 25 times faster, depending on applications and so forth, also with much greater capacity or bandwidth than a coaxial cable, which may be important when we come to financial transactions. So these early fiber optic cables had reliability problems as severe as their 19th century predecessors because they were attacked by sharks. So sharks are electroreceptive. They have little sensors in their mouths where they can detect the electric current given off by their prey. And fiber optic cables give off a lot of electric current. So in a longer version of this talk, I show a YouTube video, which I encourage you to go online and take a look at, of shark attacking fiber optic cable, which is a documented phenomenon. What they had to figure out was they had to surround the cable with Kevlar, the same thing troops wear on the battlefield, in order to protect it from shark attacks. So they figured out how to do that in 1988 with TAT-8, transatlantic telephone cable number 8, that went into service at the end of the 1980s, which is the point in time from which we would date the initial availability of the information and communications technology needed to support long-distance electronic foreign exchange trading. As recently as 2006, 99%, fully 99% of international communications traffic was carried by submarine cable, only 1% by satellite. So we all now are used to cell phone towers and privately launched satellites that carry the bulk of telephonic traffic. That's a recent transition. But it's still the case today that fiber optic cables are the principal conduit for data transmission, other than telephone calls, for the internet in general, and electronic trading of foreign exchange in particular, because they're faster and more reliable, albeit more expensive per unit of information. Importantly, for our purposes, PTAT-1 was underwritten by a consortium of telephone companies, which built it to carry telephonic traffic in competition with AT&T and British Telecom, not for purposes related to electronic or other trading of foreign exchange. So this is a big profitable industry, submarine fiber optic cables, and it's got an industry association and various publications associated with it. So we read them all to the extent we could find them, and we did not find for the period that we were concerned with mentions of financial applications of this technology. There are plenty of them for later periods outside our sample period. So now we have a submarine fiber optic cable laid expressly for trading purposes. It's called Hibernia Express because it's faster. It's a straighter shot between London and New York, therefore less latency time, but it opened in 2016 after our sample period ends. This company has acquired other cables out of bankruptcy as well, which doesn't affect our analysis either. We all know, courtesy of my neighbor in Berkeley, Michael Lewis, that we now also have a handful of terrestrial fiber optic cable connections laid for trading related purposes. The one Michael wrote about connecting Chicago with New York, another privately financed cable connecting Zurich with Frankfurt. You can put these on telephone poles, and where I live, there are trucks all over town laying fiber optic cables on telephone calls. But if you do that, they're subject to damage from storms. In my neighborhood, squirrels and human interference. To be suitable for high-value transactions, cables have to be buried in trenches. It's expensive to dig trenches. It's hard to acquire the property rights. So those cables remain relatively few. And again, they are outside of our sample period. And the next thing which is coming is high-speed microwave transmission, where you can communicate even faster using microwaves. If you can build these gigantic senders and receptors, these 1,000-foot-high masts, if the politicians and environmentalists permit companies to build them, they will do so. Again, not a technology that was relevant in our sample period. The timing of connections, how the system was rolled out, was also affected by other plausibly exogenous factors like topography. So you need a convenient landing point. So here are the cables that connect me in California with Asia. They come ashore in Manchester, California, which is a town nobody has ever heard of, which is convenient for security related reasons, and they have a really smooth beach that can be used for the transition from as the cable lands from the sea. Other countries have rather less accommodating topographies. Iceland would be an example of such a rocky cliff, much of which is surrounded by cliffs. Country only finally connected to the cable network 15 years later in 2004. And that's the map of where Manchester, California actually is. So all that is a long-winded way of saying we make an exogeneity assumption about when different countries were connected up to the global cable network. We assume that fiber optic cables were laid for general telecommunications needs, not for needs related to financial markets. That layout and rollout were further shaped by security considerations, that they were also influenced by geographic considerations related to seabed access and topography. So that assumption can be questioned unavoidably. It's irresistible, we've learned, for referees to question it. So we went back to the analysis, and these points about seabed topography point to an instrument. We use seabed ruggedness as an instrument for the presence or absence of a cable connection. Specifically, we look at the ruggedness of the most direct route between each country, the financial capital of each country, and the nearest of New York, London, and Tokyo. And I'll come back to the New York, London, and Tokyo part in a moment. Obviously, those are the leading international financial centers for foreign exchange trading because those are the centers where Reuters and electronic brokerage services, EBS, maintain their matching servers. And ruggedness is measured as changes in seabed depth or elevation relative to the seabed level over the relevant cell, if you will.
Is ruggedness time varying?
Ruggedness? So far as I know, seabed ruggedness is not time varying, no. So we look at ruggedness of the seabed, and we also look at the shortest route, taking into account the ups and downs that the cable has to traverse to get from A to B. And we basically get the same results as with the simpler approach that I'm focusing on here. So we look at the reaction of the exchange rate to news. Everything here is standard. We treat the exchange rate as an asset price, as a function of expected future fundamentals based on information at time t. It follows that the log return, the change in the log exchange rate, is a function of the change in expected discounted future fundamentals. For ease of comparison, we standardize by the variability of the fundamental in question. I described before how we look at a variety of different fundamentals or news variables. So we're basically replicating what Anderson and his co-authors did in an American Economic Review article about 15 years ago, examining the reaction of exchange rates to news with the addition of this cable's variable, whether there was a connection between country J on day T to matching servers in London, New York, or Tokyo, because that's where the foreign exchange trading disproportionately, though not exclusively, takes place. And because our own previous work shows that those are the connections that matter for other behavior in the foreign exchange market. So the data come from a collection of different sources. The data on cables come from this interesting company and website called Telegeography that gives you more information about the cables than we actually end up using, about their physical characteristics, their carrying capacity, when they were placed into service, importantly for us, and the like. Data on exchange rates and news come from more standard sources. As I said before, we look at exchange rates against the dollar. We look at 56 currencies, where the Anderson et al. Study that we're building on looked at five. We define exchange rates here, I guess in European rather than US fashion, as the dollar price of foreign currencies, dollars per Korean won, for example. The daily data on exchange rates come from Bloomberg, spanning 1997 through 2015. And the news data come from Bloomberg as well. So Bloomberg publishes surveys of professional forecasters of what they expect the unemployment rate to be, or what they expect the Federal Reserve's policy rate to be. And the news is the difference between the announcement and the relevant expectation. Finally, we use data on where currencies are traded that comes from the Bank for International Settlements triannual surveys. So people in this audience will be familiar with those surveys, which have information on volume. But they also have information on whether a currency is traded onshore. The Korean won is traded onshore if it's traded in Seoul. And it's traded offshore if it's traded in, say, New York, London, or Tokyo. And we construct a variable indicator for offshore when the share of trading in that currency is greater than the sample median for that period. So we estimate our returns equation using a variety of different specifications. Sometimes we include currency fixed effects, so we're focusing only on changes in currency reactions over time, before and after cable, if you will, although those currency fixed effects don't seem to matter very much in practice. The simple pooling seems to work as well, and the fixed effects are not very significant. So as an alternative, we cluster standard errors by currency. In some work, we control also for time effects to take into account the possibility that the structure of the market and the structure of the environment in which currencies are traded is changing over time. So you might have an argument that the news about Federal Reserve policy rates might have a different impact on the foreign exchange market in good times and bad times, or in periods when policy rates are very low, as they have been recently, as opposed to earlier in the sample period, or that trading strategies and algorithms have changed over time, as they clearly have, so the time fixed effects go some ways toward picking up those global features that change over time, but presumably affect different currencies in similar ways. We look similarly at advanced country currencies and emerging market currencies. In some work, we drop sterling and the yen with the idea that they might be special in the same way that the dollar was special, insofar as their markets are home to a disproportionate amount of foreign exchange trades. And we look at different kinds of cable connections. Do you have a straight shot to London, Tokyo, or New York? Or alternatively, are you indirectly connected through a network which passes through a number of third countries before you news via cable gets from, to pick a city at random, Kuala Lumpur to Tokyo or whatever? And you will see some of this sensitivity analysis in the tables that follow. So the equations that I show you here regress the dollar exchange rate pooled for a bunch of different currencies on a vector of news variables, which you can read down the column, and various fixed effects and sometimes other controls, which I don't report here. And you can see the unsurprising finding that a US policy interest rate surprise, the Fed raises its policy rate relative to expectations, strengthens the dollar exchange rate. That's the same result that Anderson et al. Found 15 years earlier for their more limited sample of currencies. And you can see that that effect holds for all days, only news days, with fixed currency fixed effects and time effects, et cetera, et cetera. But a cable connection appears to dampen that response. So here I'm showing you four, three different samples. Again, the positive impact on the value of the dollar of a positive Federal Reserve interest rate surprise, and how that is that effect is dampened. It is neutralized in large part by the existence of a cable connection for that currency on that day. And you can see visually that the conditional response to a surprise of given magnitude is smaller in the presence of a cable, the lightly shaded line, than in its absence, the more darkly shaded. In addition, the effect seems to vary depending on where a currency is traded, onshore or offshore, and that may end up going some ways toward answering your question. So you can see this in the next couple of slides. Here, you continue to get a positive impact on the value of the dollar from a Federal Reserve interest rate surprise. You continue to see that effect dampened in considerable part by the presence of a cable connection. But In addition, you see that that holds only when a currency is traded disproportionately onshore. It holds when the Korean won is traded mainly in Seoul. It doesn't hold were the Korean won to be traded mainly in Tokyo. And I think there is, one can imagine, I don't have a direct test of these possible interpretations of that difference, but here are some domestic onshore traders, Korean traders trading the won in Seoul, and foreign offshore traders can have different interpretations of the same news. And there are some analytical models designed to flesh out that intuition. Or traders in New York, one of the principal offshore centers, are located in the country where US news is emitted. They may have an informational advantage, especially in the absence of cable connections. Traders in large financial centers, not just New York, but also London and Tokyo, may have an information advantage over traders in smaller centers because in large centers they have access to proprietary databases, information on order flow, they can consult with in-house experts, and that may make a difference in general and in the absence of cable connections in particular. So the common implication of these stories is that currencies traded mainly in large financial centers shouldn't necessarily react differently to US news following the establishment of a cable connection. Whereas in contrast, currencies traded mainly onshore in the issuing country should react less following the establishment of a cable connection, insofar as traders in those onshore markets now have better access to and trade on information produced by dealers, banks, consultancies, et cetera. And that difference between the reaction of onshore and currencies traded mainly onshore and currencies traded mainly offshore holds not only for the US policy interest rate, but it holds for news about GDP, industrial production, the consumer price index, the unemployment rate, and the trade balance to a considerable degree. And this presentation makes the contrast between G10 and non-G10 currencies that Jonathan asked about less pronounced than before. So that's it. We find that cable connections dampen the response of exchange rates to news. An interpretation of that finding is that information technology levels the information playing field, if you will, by easing access to information and reduces trend following behavior. The effects are large. A cable connection substantially reduces the reaction of exchange rates to US monetary policy news in particular, but the extent of that effect depends on the structure of the market, in particular on where a currency is traded. So there is a paper. We are still at work on it. I think it is linked to the website for the conference. So we have a